Okay, thank you. Thank you, Matti. Thank you, Vice President. And thank you for the Aalto community to attend this talk. So I think everybody of you knows wetting. So here is one example. So this glass is dry and I'm now filling it with water. So the surfaces of the glass are now wetted. And we experience in our daily life when we wash our clothes or ourselves in the shower or so we notice surfaces they typically get wet. The type of surfaces that I will talk about today, so they do not get wet actually. So these are extremely water repellent, and you see here one example that I will describe in more detail later. So there are all kinds of problems related to surfaces. Surfaces have a tendency to get dirty, especially very clean surfaces have a tendency to get dirty. You all need to wash your car, your clothes, whatever. And actually also companies, they are interested actually in keeping their products clean for the customers. Also, fogging, so condensating of droplets on surfaces is a problem. So maybe you recognize this person. I was at the Indian Institute of Technology in Chennai, Madras, and so when I stepped outside of the airport, the air is very humid there, and my glasses, I could not see through them anymore. So you experience this nowadays when it's getting colder also in your car. So this is also a problematic thing. And also soon, when the winter gets colder, also icing, frosting is a problem. So when you take an airplane, so you want to travel safely and you don't want ice to deposit on the wings. So there are solutions to these problems, or we are working towards real solutions. There is quite much to learn from how nature has done it. So nature has evolution for millions of years to find solutions for all kinds of problems. This is a lotus leaf, so it's a plant that is from Asia, and it lives in muddy waters, but the leaves are always clean. And you see here a drop of water rolling around it, and if there are sand particles, so they rather stick to the droplet than to the leaf, keeping the surface clean. So the plant needs it for doing photosynthesis, but you can also imagine that the solar cells on your rooftop could benefit from such coating. So how to make surfaces where, that have properties that they do not stick, or that water has low friction to it? So would it need to be smooth, or would it need to be rough? So you would think, so if you are, let's say, treating wood or so, you want to have a smooth, so then you use some sandpaper to smoothen it, so to decrease the roughness. But for water, it's actually quite the opposite. So here we need to introduce surface roughness. And to explain why, so I need to tell you a little bit behind surface tension phenomena. So liquids are composed of molecules, such as water in this case. And if you are in the bulk liquid, so the molecules are surrounded by many other molecules, and they all attract each other. But the average force for this molecule, it is about zero, because it's pulled at all directions about equally. But that's different for a molecule that is positioned at the water surface. So here there are forces pulling it towards the bulk liquid, but there are no molecules at the other side, at the air side, that can pull to it. So there is a force that leads to a tension at the water surface, and that leads to a phenomenon, capillary phenomenon as we call them, that are let's say that looks like it is a there is some kind of a surface at the water or some kind of elastic surface at the water surface. So and one example, if you have a tap and it is dripping water, so you can see that the surface tension forces are actually pulling the droplet together so that the droplet gets a spherical shape. So this is entirely due to surface tension forces that want to minimize surface energy. So, but then, when a water droplet gets in contact with a surface, so there are different things that can happen. So a surface can be hydrophilic. So hydro is water, philic means loving. The contact angles are very low, below 90 degrees. So this is how we define the contact angle. And for example, this glass is a hydrophilic surface. Now, there are also hydrophobic surfaces where the contact angle is higher. We define it as higher than 90 degrees. And one example is, for example, in your frying pan, you may have such a layer that prevents sticking. So those have high contact angles. But it is known that for smooth surfaces, the highest contact angle possible is only 120 degrees. So, but we know there exist superhydrophobic surfaces, so that have contact angles of much more, so higher than 150 degrees. So these are super extremely water-fearing surfaces. Now, how are they made? So there are two things that you need. On one hand, you need to have a suitable surface chemistry, low polar surface chemistry, such as here alkyl tails or fluoro alkyl tails. But on the other hand, you need to have also a roughness at the nanoscale, a topography at the nano or at the microscale. So in case of the lotus leaf, it is these. So these are about 10 micrometer bumps. But you can make them also by lithography sticks. You can make fibers, all kinds of surface roughness. At these nano-micro length scale will lead to superhydrophobic surface. And the reason is that the droplet is then actually mostly in contact with air, the air below the droplet, and not with the solid surface. So there is a thin layer of air trapped below the droplet, between the droplet and the surface, leading to a very high contact angle, but also it has very low friction. So the droplet is very mobile, it does not stick on the surface. And you see here an example of a surface. So this is a copper surface that we have treated, where you have droplets that are very mobile. You have a dimple if you actually force the surface underwater. So there is a dimple, so the water surface gets highly curved. And also, if you notice the part that is underwater, there is an optical reflection. And there is a thin air layer trapped between the solid substrate and the water, leading to a very optically smooth surface and optical reflection. Now, one of the major problems of superhydrophobic surfaces is that they do not last so long. So if you touch it or with sandpaper, then typically they get damaged. Whereas normally a superhydrophobic surface droplets roll off easily when it gets damaged. So the droplet can still have a high contact angle, but it's pinned to the surface, it stays stuck. So, and that is something what we have addressed in this paper here. So, and that's actually the bottleneck to commercialization is actually that they are so fragile mechanically. Now, people are working on solutions. Also, our group has done share in that. So one potential problem here is that if you have created a surface roughness, you add a hydrophobic coating. So typically, the surface roughness is made in a hydrophilic material. You add a hydrophobic coating. But if you damage it, there is a part that is hydrophilic that is exposed, and that water likes to stick on it. So that's a problem. So there are many different kinds of solutions. Two are depicted here. So one is if you have damaged your surface, that it actually can self-heal. So some surfaces can actually heal spontaneously. to recover its wetting properties, similar as we cut our skin slightly. So also in a few days or so, the wound disappears. One other solution could be if we start completely from a hydrophobic bulk material, so then there are no hydrophilic pinning sites. Okay, but there is also one other big challenge, and it's related to the characterization of the wetting properties. So here you see a water droplet on a superhydrophobic surface. And if we look in more detail, so these are actually results from a group of Hans-Jürgen Boot. It's actually, so here is a superhydrophobic layer and a water droplet, but it's actually very difficult to determine what is actually the contact angle. Is it 170? Is it 175? There are different technical reasons why it is actually very difficult. But like the contact angle measurement is today still the gold standard for wetting measurements. Now, other problems is that actually, so these are not sensitive for superhydrophobic surfaces. Also, there is currently not really a tool to look at very tiny microscopic features because these droplets are millimeter-sized. And there is also no tool to look at small differences, and certainly also you need actually surfaces that are flat, so where you can have optically look at the interface here. So if you have a surface like a piece of fabric that is a bit curved, it's very difficult to measure contact angles. So this is some new work. We call it scanning droplet adhesion microscopy, where we measure with a water droplet the force upon contact, first contact, and also when the surface is released from the droplet. So here you see a droplet coming into contact, and it is actually released. We measure the forces, and we are here capable in measuring very tiny forces in the nanonewton range. And what we have done here, so we have built the first wetting microscope, where we can, by scanning the surface, in an array, so we can create a wetting map of these snap-in, the first contact force, and also pull off when the surface is actually released from the droplet. And we managed to do it on an eye spot of a butterfly wing here as an example. Now, one other method that we have developed is on measuring the friction of a surface. So we have here a water droplet that contains very small amount of magnetic nanoparticles. So this water droplet becomes attracted to the magnet here. And when it becomes attracted to the magnet, so it starts oscillating over the surface. So the oscillations are actually decaying, so they are reduced in amplitude. And as you can see here, we can record it. And from these oscillations, we are capable in measuring also the friction forces, also with nano-Newton precision. And what is more is that this method should have inverse sensitivity. So the more repellent the surface is, the more accurate the measurement would become. Then some other work we have done with magnetic droplets. I will stop the video here now. So when we have a concentrated droplet, so very high concentration of magnetic particles, it's still a water droplet. And then if you look at this part, so here is the magnet, here is a droplet. And the droplet already has changes shape. But then it starts, So then the droplet starts to divide in multiple smaller droplets. So there is a competition of forces. So there are magnetic forces, there are surface tension forces, and there is gravity. And the combination of these forces, these are competing, makes that the droplet becomes unstable and it cleaves in multiple smaller droplets, what you will see happening now. And each droplet actually becomes a magnet by itself. And as you know, you probably have also played with magnets. So if you turn a magnet, if you have two magnets and you turn one upside down, then they can either attract or they can repel, depending on the orientation. So here, the droplets, these are magnets that repel each other. And that leads to self-assembly. You see that the droplets, they form an array, ordered array of droplets. And so this is used as a model system for self-assembly. And here you can see when we have cleaved into many tens of droplets that there is a very ordered array formed as a competition of forces that the droplets repel each other locally, but they are attracted towards the magnets, all of them. And then finally, one other example about how these droplets are inspired from nature, or these surfaces are inspired from nature, is so there are insects that live underwater that have some superhydrophobic surface, exoskeleton. You can see it also here, the light reflection. And they have such a hairy structure that can actually support the air layer. So, and they are actually using it not only that they can be dry when they climb out of the water, but they are actually using it as a lung. So it's really remarkable. So they breathe using this air layer underwater. Now, what some insect researchers had actually discovered was that the air retention is more stable if you have a dual scale structure. So if you have large hair and small hair combined. So, and we have tried to mimic such a structure where we have also large scale pillars in a silicon wafer, and we have coated them with some nanoscale structure. And now we have also observed the same. So these nanoscale structure makes these surfaces very stable. So the air layer is very stable on these structures. So when we, for example, apply pressure on it, so the water gets filled in between the pillars, but we can actually reverse this process by a suction because there is still this air layer present. And that's something what you see in this movie. So here is the surface at the bottom of a tank, and we actually fill it with water. And you can already see that it's very repellent to the liquid. Now, so it gets completely filled. There is a thin layer of air trapped on the surface. And now we start writing. So we just write with a jet of water, underwater. So, and that leads to a change in, it's a wetting transition here, a change in optical reflection. And this is a reversible optical transition. So we can also erase this structure. Okay. So then, to conclude, so so superhydrophobic surfaces are very exciting materials. So lots of things are inspired from nature, from plant leaves, insect wings, duck feathers, for example. And there's lots of technological potential. So self-cleaning, anti-fogging, anti-icing. I did not mention also anti-corrosion and heat transfer. They may have advantages. But the problem, one of the problems is that it's very difficult to measure wetting properties, but we are working on solutions for that. And also to bring them to the shop around the corner. So we need to solve the problem of the fragility of these surfaces. Okay, and then finally, I need to thank students and postdocs from my group, and also the Heiberg Center of Excellence, and the many collaborators nationally and internationally, and the funding received from Academy of Finland, ERC, and Aalto University. And thank you for the attention.